What's up, everybody? Once again, it's Friend Man Sean, and we got to talk about the nitty gritty details of how Blueface blew up, and then we're going to talk about why he's the next big Atlanta rapper. That part will be explained. Don't get your panties in a bunch. Now, there's three things, by the way, all really important when it comes to his rise, but first we're going to talk about the strategy. Now, versions of this strategy have been used for a minute, but now apparently it's been popularized as the pump strategy, as in Lil Pump. Now, the pump strategy is actually known as a 10-step strategy, but two very important parts of this strategy is setting the stage for an artist by turning them into a meme and then using that foundation to make them go viral. Now, when we talk about Blueface, this guy definitely turned into a meme. All last year, well, the second half of last year, you heard a lot about how this guy's always offbeat. And that became the meme that he represented. People talked about him because he was so offbeat in his music. Now, there were other additional memes when it came to Blueface, but that one in particular was the strongest. And also was pretty helpful because that actually kind of doubles as a sort of controversy, which is another thing that gets used in the pump strategy. It's kind of like if you already know who Blueface is and then you see next big Atlanta rapper next to his picture, and you're gonna be like, yo, whoever this person is stupid. Let me go talk about how stupid they are in the comments. This brand man guy has to be slow. Now, although there's a sense of logical tie-in that I'll get to when I get to point number three, it's still the same type of energy that a lot of these memes look to create for no reason at all. But just check out a few of the many memes that got created about Blueface. Now, actually getting memes to catch is a little bit more complicated than a lot of people think. And the hint is they aren't necessarily fan generated. But I tell you, it works, it works, it works. I essentially used the same method back in 2016 when I created a festival and basically got a big ass turnout with zero marketing dollars, just creating posts myself and kind of put them out into the marketplace. And the way I think of it is it really falls in line with a very popular quote that sometimes people say is Gandhi, sometimes people argue that it's not Gandhi. First they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, then you win. Now, first they ignore you, that one's pretty straightforward. You're in obscurity, nobody knows who you are, so it doesn't matter, you don't matter. Now, the second thing is, then they laugh at you. That part is a little bit tweaky when you think about the fact of being a meme. People don't have to necessarily laugh at you. A lot of times it's pretty popular to do things that entertain people and make people laugh because, you know, that's just one of the easier things to do on Instagram. But you can also make people feel like you're weird, just do some scary things, some trippy things, some dangerous things. There's a lot of different ways to kind of pull on that emotion. The most interesting thing that you see is that typically in life in general, people spend most of their time trying to get people to feel positive emotions about them. But when it comes to this particular process, you're really trying to get people to feel not completely negative emotions about people, but you're trying to pull the most easily reactive nerves on people, right? You're trying to get them to react, and it's easy to do that when it's something negative. For whatever reason, people just be that way. So there you go, you got it. You're kind of a meme, you got people feeling some sort of emotion about you, that meme is popular, there might be multiple memes in relation to you. Then the next thing is, then they fight you. Now, what's this fight like? Well, if you think about Blueface, it's, yo, man, this dude is offbeat. This dude, I can't rock with him. I'm making fun of him. I'm laughing at him. But at some point, you have some people starting to say, but this is kind of dope, though. I don't completely dislike it. Why do I like that's that fight? And actually, a perfect example and one of the funniest things that I read that are kind of symbolic of the then they fight you slash even still just being a meme was this YouTube comment that I saw commonly within his videos. Blueface, you don't know me, but I was in a tragic accident in 2009, paralyzed from the neck down. It's been a hard few years, but today I stood up and walked to turn your music off. God bless you. I was rolling the first time I read that. And then you have the people who are just violently fighting and saying, this person is trash, this person is trash, this person is trash, and just creating more energy around that person. It's polarization. But what that really does is set the stage for the last part, which is then you win. Now that then you win part could come at completely different times for fans. Everybody comes down the marketing funnel at their own pace. But for a lot of people, when Blueface came out with Bleed It, they were like, yo, all right, this dude's on beat. This junk is kind of hard. If you look at it, or I didn't even look at the stats, but I can guarantee, let me not say guarantee because I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that Bleed It probably has his most views on a video so far. Why? Because you're not just gonna go into the comment section and just talk about it. But this is something that you'll actually replay again and again and again. All right, so moving on to the second big reason that a lot of artists who might wanna try to mimic the same thing need to understand, and I'm gonna see if you can guess it. On March 17th, Dead Low dropped on Blueface's YouTube page, and on September 28th, Blow Her Back dropped on his YouTube page. Other than that, on July 5th, Tatiana dropped on Worldstar. On September 9th, Next Big Thing dropped on Worldstar. On September 23rd, Two Cox dropped on Worldstar. On October 1st, Fuck Them dropped on Worldstar. On October 8th, Respect My Crippin' dropped on Worldstar. On October 21st, Freak Bitch dropped on Worldstar. And on December 14th, Studio dropped on Worldstar. Now, obviously, Worldstar played a huge part in the blowing this guy up, but what is number two? What am I really trying to say? I'm actually talking about the money, man. The money. Now, it's pretty well known that Worldstar pretty regularly charges about $7,000 to put a video up on their page. Now, they might not necessarily had to pay that because there might have been a deal set up since it was so many videos. Who knows? But the point is, let's just say that each of these videos was $7,000. That's seven videos that I read through, multiply that by seven, that's $49,000. And that's to post them, not to shoot them. Money, money, money. And when you look at Bleed It got posted on Lyrical Lemonade on December 19th. That as well cost some money, and you know, Lyrical Lemonade, they shoot the videos because they have a unique style. But there's one thing to even think about as far as the frequency of being posted on Worldstar in particular. It doesn't have to be just Worldstar, but if you think back to one of the Saturday videos I posted recently when I was just ranting, him being posted on Worldstar again and again and again allowed him to get back in front of the same audience. So not just the money to actually be able to get posted, but not just doing a whole bunch of random places, being inserted in front of an audience and the same and or very, very similar audience is a beneficial thing at the end of the day. So that's kind of an add-on, but really I want you to focus on the money and really think about how much it really takes to get these artists to the level that you guys are just thinking like, oh, all I gotta do is do something ignorant, do something stupid, and I'm gonna blow up. To really blow up, not go viral, but to blow up as a brand, it costs some money. And number three is this whole Atlanta rapper thing that I referred to earlier. What I really mean by that is just his rap having a lot of humor in it. Now, Atlanta by no means is the only place that has rappers that have humor in their lyrics, and it's been that way for a long period of time. However, when you think about the style that New York blew up with, the style that the West Coast blew up with on a commercial scale, Atlanta actually got popularized with what's still dominating today, which is another reason Atlanta is known as a dominant force. Fun, a little what people consider to be ignorant, and just funny, right? Fun and funny, especially when you think about the crunk era and then how that kind of evolved into the Soulja Boys. And that whole idea is really tailor-made for not only the youth, but really just the internet in general. It's built for memes. But for real, that comedic style, think about people like 2 Chainz, Quavo, 21 Savage. If you listen to their lyrics, they be saying some funny stuff, but they aren't even like comedic style rappers. They aren't even trying to come off as super funny, but they still say some funny stuff. That's why people enjoy singing their lyrics, because at the same time, this is like this joke. That's what makes it so fun to repeat their lyrics. They're good at sliding that in a serious manner, as opposed to being like an extreme, like an Eminem or a Lil Dicky. And Blueface definitely has had a lot of lines that have you cracking up. For example, if you look at the song Blow Her Back, pound for pound, that song probably has the most funny lines out of all his songs. For example, her ass looked like two midgets in a sleeping bag. That's the chorus, people. Put my meat in her cheese, bitch, I'm still nachos. Stupid. I didn't text back, but she still got the message. Even when TJ, who was featured on the songs, had a lot of comedic lines. My favorite line of his is, you acting really bougie, but your elbow's ashy. Now that's three important factors when it comes to the blow up of Blueface. But before I go, I gotta mention something that's kind of an X factor when it comes to this guy right here. When you think about Tekashi 6ix9ine, even X, and so many of the artists, when they're memes for things outside their music, is really interesting and a real advantage when it comes to Blueface, that a huge part of his meme and his narrative was just being offbeat because it forces you to listen to the music in the first place to hear him being offbeat. It can't get much better than that, people. And to be honest, it was kind of interesting that it was a big deal to me. I guess, you know, maybe the team was probably a part of pushing this narrative, but I thought the same thing when I first heard T Grizzly. As a matter of fact, he sounded similar to me. That's just my opinion though. First day out grew on me, but I was like, yo, like what's going on here? Would love to know you guys' thoughts on this video. What's interesting? Have you used any of these tactics? Yada, 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 all that good stuff. So if you like this video, go ahead and hit the like button. If you like it, might as well share it. And if you're not subscribed, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button.